your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in these holy mysteries gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
First lesson, a reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If the household is too small for a whole lamb, shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood, put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, this is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hands, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you should do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. But if you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. I'm feeling quiet, contemplative, a little sad. Tonight has a lot going on. We don't even hear the whole story of what all is happening tonight. What we do hear is mostly from Jesus talking about washing feet and why he's washing feet. But there's a lot more that happens between now and tomorrow, or now and the arrest of Jesus. And so I'm kind of feeling all of these things, all of the emotions of Jesus bringing all of these people to have a meal in an upper room, to what's going to come next tonight in the arrest. But our gospel doesn't go there. Our readings don't go all the way through. They don't go through Jesus' talk to his disciples and with his disciples. We don't hear the prayers that Jesus prays for the disciples and for us. But they're really poignant and they're really important to what we are doing today, what we are preparing for today. They are up in the upper room, and a lot of times we think about it as being at the Passover. But it isn't quite Passover. It's the preparation for the Passover. But it isn't even the preparation for Passover. It's the day before that. The day of preparation is the day that Jesus is crucified. It's the day before that that they get together and they have this meal. We hear the Passover story so that we can understand what it is Passover is about. So that was what we heard from Exodus today. I don't know about you, but I have my eyes closed, and I might have been thinking a little bit too closely to the Ten Commandments lately. But it's very, if you've seen it, everybody's seen it, right? It's hard to not think about it when you hear that story to Charlton Heston. Something about that. And then we jump to 1 Corinthians, and we jump to the disciples teaching Paul, teaching people about what it is about the Lord's Supper, which is what Jesus also shares bread and wine with the disciples at this time. But the meat of of the story is in Jesus bending down on his knees and washing the feet of the disciples. And then there's Judas. There's a little bit about Judas and his betrayal of Jesus. But we actually skip that whole section of this gospel, literally. If you look at the numbers, we read John 3, 1 to 17, and then, oh, here we go, the 31b. So we skip a whole bunch of verses about him and what happens there. So we really are focusing in on what about washing the feet. I spent time reading a lot of different articles about foot washing in Christian century over the course of years, and how people have responded, and how people have responded to feet, responded to this particular gospel. They had asked people to write stories or poetry, and the only prompt that they had was feet. And every single story came back to this story of being a servant. A lot of times we think about this time as this time of Jesus washing feet as, you know, they're just washing their dirty feet because they walk in the dust all of the time, and the feet, maybe they didn't wash their feet really well when they came in the building, and that type of thing. But it's a little bit deeper than that. Jesus is showing them that he is washing them clean. They are followers of Christ. They're followers of Jesus. And he is taking this piece of their body. How many of you like your feet? Do you like your feet? I mean, think about that. Not too many of us like our feet. So many priests, I get the little reminder, don't forget to get a pedicure before Monday, Thursday. You know? Well, no. But that happens. I mean, there's a lot of people who do that. And it isn't about whether my feet are going to be pretty when I take my shoes off this evening. It's going to be about my feet being washed by one of you as a sign of intimacy, as a sign, well, we don't even hardly know each other yet. It's still a sign, except for Jeff. It's a sign of intimacy. It's a sign of commitment and relationship. And Jesus gets down and he washes their feet, and he doesn't just dribble water on it and pat them dry. He gets in there and he washes and he massages and he spends time in a way that is so one-on-one that maybe those disciples have never had that close of an encounter with Jesus until that. And we get to relive, okay, those of us who want to get our feet washed, and I know I've been told there's not many of you, but it's an intimacy. It is an opportunity for us to really be in communion with another individual. And you may not know that person very well, and you may not always like that person, or, you know, we all have relationships, we all have emotions, and we don't. God didn't say you have to like each other. God said, you have to love each other. Okay? So you're going to come here and you're going to express yourself to a person that you feel whatever ways you feel about. And show them this deep emotion that, I mean, it could go you. I mean, please don't go you. It's not about that. It's really about what are we doing. How are we expressing and how are we honoring these feet that go from this place out into the world? And the washing of our feet helps us to do that in a way that is a servant, is expressing God's love to the world. Again, maybe not with people you like all the time or that you know all the time. So this is our opportunity to be vulnerable with one another, to share just such an intimate moment of massage. If we had oils, if we had ointments, if we had creams, we could do all of those things, and it could be a mini pedicure, I guess. But the idea is that we are recognizing the gift of that other person as a person in the body of Christ, as a person who is a part of who we are as a community together. You're still not going to get judged if you don't come forward. But I hope next year you will. I hope you think about it. I hope you think about what you experience and what you understand this to be. Love comes from God, and this is one way that we express love on a very intimate one-on-one. But it is designed so that we can go out into the world and share that love. And that love comes from God. We see it in the story from Exodus, from the Passover. We see it in Jesus, who was sent here because we weren't listening as a people. We were not listening to God. We were not doing what God was wanting, and we were forgetting who we belong to. That's God, that way. And so God sent Jesus as a baby to teach us, as he became a man, how to love one another, how to be in relationship with one another, how to feed the hungry, sit with the poor, be with the dying, massage the feet of one another. That's love. That's the love that God has asked us to practice with one another and with the world. So I invite you to come forward and have your feet washed. In that moment, release your anxiety of having your feet washed. And instead, sit with the emotion of being so cared for by the individual washing your feet. So strengthened or so prepared and so much cleaner so that your heart and your soul and your mind are ready to walk out into the world after you have been fed from the body and the blood of Christ, the ultimate gift of love. And then when it's your turn to wash someone else's feet, I invite you to think about that person. What do you know about that person? Do you know what ministries they do in the church? Do you know what gifts they bring to this community? As you wash their feet, think about how they have impacted you personally, how they have impacted this faith community, and how you see them impacting the world. See the Christ in them. See the disciple in them. And if it's someone that you have had a problem with, find forgiveness. Offer forgiveness from your heart. You don't have to say a word. But offer forgiveness, offer peace, offer strength, offer acceptance, and ultimately, offer them your love. Amen. Page 274, I invite you to pray with me. The Lord Jesus, after he had supped with his disciples and had washed their feet, said to them, "Do you know what I, your Lord and Master, have done to you? I have given you an example that you should do as I have done. This is my last gift to you. My own peace I now leave with you. Peace which the world cannot give, I give to you. I give you a new commandment, love one another as I have loved you. Peace is my last gift to you. My own peace I now leave with you. Peace which the world cannot give, I give to you. By this shall the world know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another. We will have some time of washing the feet. There will be a hymn that you can sing along with. It's hymn number 576. I'm going to start by washing Mary's feet, who I just met in person today. I have no relationship with her besides a two-hour phone call. So that's a big deal, I think. And then Mary will take over to whoever is going to come next. You're invited to come forward. You don't have to come running forward. You can take your time. It is okay. You want to remove both your feet. Both, not your feet. Your shoes and your socks. And let her wash your feet. And when she is done washing your feet, then you will wash the next person's feet. And I will be the last person to have my feet washed. So I will be watching to see when that might be. So I invite you to come forward and experience this. If you feel on this holy night as we begin these sacred 3 days and prepare through fasting and prayer to celebrate the Paschal Feast. Let us earnestly pray to God for all those eating tonight with Christ and for all peoples everywhere to commit ourselves to love and serve one another.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Kyrie eleison. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord. For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Terry, our bishop, for Debbie, our rector, for Mary, our deacon, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease, and that all may be one as you and the Father are one. Pray to you, O Lord. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, for all who mourn throughout the world, for the innocent ones injured or killed in recent violence throughout our country and the world, for those impacted by the forces of nature, we pray to you, O Lord. For those in positions of public trust, especially Joe, our president, Andy, our governor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who live and work in this community, especially Oldham County and all surrounding counties, we pray to you, O Lord. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and for all who suffer, especially for those on our prayer list, Bobby, Dorothy, Francisco, Jackie, James, Lisa, Ralph and Charlene, Stephanie, Susan, Tom, Trey, Virginia, for those who have received our healing blankets, and for all refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. For this congregation, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart, show forth your glory in all that we do. We pray to you, O Lord. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being free from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. We pray to you, O Lord. For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed James, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God. To you, O Lord,
yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Please stand. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. page 361. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
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 we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. eternal God, heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. A moment of direction. I invite you to stay seated or go to a seated position. After the blessing, we will sing our final hymn from a seated position. And then Mary and I will strip the altar, and we invite you to stay and observe and listen to the music that Daniel has prepared for us. When the altar has completed being stripped, you are invited to walk quietly. If you would like to go and spend some time in vigil in the Savior room, there is a garden set up in there with wolves that you can meet. It will be open until 10 o'clock this evening. It is a time for you to just be present with God. I'm going to ask you to stand for a blessing. May Christ crucified draw you to himself. May you find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.